All right, guys, welcome back to the summary class for week two, okay? In today's class, we will first start with a HackerRank problem. The reason for that is I somehow believe that in the last class, in the last week, when I actually discussed the HackerRank problem at the very end, I thought that, you know, maybe everybody was already drained out. And I somehow believe that, you know, they were not able to kind of understand how exactly we got the solution to the problem. So we will start fresh with a HackerRank problem. The HackerRank problem is called as counting valleys, okay? We will understand the problem first and then we will solve it. The next one is we will obviously run through the week two classes. Then we will talk about the assignments and then the list of week three topics. That's the usual trend that we are following. Okay, so let's go and first understand the HackerRank problem that we are trying to solve. So this is the HackerRank problem I have picked up. The name of this problem is called counting valleys. And let me read through this particular problem. You can read as well. So Gary is an avid hiker. He tracks his hikes, meticulously paying close attention to small details like topography. During his last hike, he took exactly n steps. Every step he took, he noted that it was an uphill, which is denoted by U, or a downhill, denoted by D, right? So Gary hikes start and ends at the sea level. Each time, each step or down, step up or down, represents one unit in the change in altitude. We define the following terms. A mountain is a sequence of consecutive steps above the sea level, starting with step up from sea level and ending with step down to sea level, okay? And valley is a sequence of consecutive steps below the sea level, starting with step down from sea level and ending up with step up to sea level. So if I'm trying to make you guys understand properly, then you will be given a string like this, D, D, U, 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 D, D. This is a sample string. D means you're stepping down. U means you're stepping up. So you have stepped down twice over here with the D, and then you're stepping up twice with U. So basically you're completing one valley. And that is the valley count that you have to figure out. So you will be given a string with a combination of D and U's, and you basically have to then figure out that how many valleys, not mountains, but how many valleys this guy has actually covered, right? So this is what you need to come out of it, you need to figure out of it, right? So just one second. Okay, we have Gokul, we have CB. All right, I think we have a few people. Perfect. So as we know, we are starting out with a HackerRank problem, and this is the problem that we are trying to solve. So for example, I will go to an example over here, okay? So you see a single underscore is basically the sea level. You're taking one step up and one step down, which is a mountain for sure, but it is not a valley. The valley starts from here. So one, 1, 2, 3, 4 is up, 5 is down. Again, couple of ups. This is one entire valley that this guy has covered. So this count is 1. This count is 1. So like that, whatever the string that will be sent to you, you need to figure out what will be the valley count. So let me try and put this into a drawing and then we will see how can we solve this. So paint X, okay? My question to everybody would be to think about the situation and tell me that what is approach. So for example, I have a string, say, D, I have a this guy called D, right? So what exactly it means? I am starting at sea level, so I'm going one down. Sorry, I'm going one down, two down, and three down. Okay, and then I'm going up, one, two, three. This is my, I'm back at sea level, and then I'm going one level up because I have one U here, right? And then again, I'm going down. That's one level down, which is again bringing back me to the sea level, but I'm not counting mountains, I'm counting valleys. And then I'm going down one and two. So my path is not yet completed here. I have just gone down, two-step down, but my path is not completed here. So I will not calculate this portion, but I will calculate this portion, which is basically three-step down and three-step up. So this is my one valley. This is my one valley. We are all discussing about the HackerRank problems. The only reason for that is I want you guys to think about algorithm. If you are not going to do much with programming until unless you understand how to break down a problem and solve it. This problem looks probably to be very complicated, but it's not. It's a simple structure. You have to think about what are different kind of counters you will have in place in order to make this work. So anybody wants to try this particular algorithm, what do you think should we do? Shiley, Shobhan, Joan, Daniel, anyone? Can you give it a try and tell me what do you think?
I think we should probably have a counter for sea level that's zero.
Okay, so for example, you're saying sea level counter, okay? Yeah. So this sea level counter will be something, sea level counter will be initiated with zero, yeah. Right? And there has to be some kind of a check that will increment this counter, but that check will be of what? The check will be that if Gary has gone same number of steps down and same number of steps up, only then increment this counter to plus one, right?
Yes, but then in the first drawing that you showed us, within the valley, there is also a mountain.
Sorry, which one?
Within the, do you remember you showed us the first drawing and it had a mountain within the valley as well? So
No. Let me go back there. So what they have is, that's fine. A valley can be count, a complete path can be constructed if Gary is coming back to the sea level. The question is that how Gary is coming back to the sea level from a valley. He is stepping down the sea level and he's coming back to the sea level. So this whole portion is considered to be valley. There could be a mountain here, that's fine. But that's not my point. My point is where exactly he's coming back up. He's coming back up to the sea level, which is zero. And once it is one complete cycle, he goes down. Maybe there are a couple of mountains in the valley, that's fine. But eventually he comes back up to the sea level. So this is going to be my count number one for the entire valley. And that is what we have to figure out. Right? So in that, yeah, go on, sorry.
We can count every time that, so every time he goes down, we can decrement the sea level counter by one. And every time it goes up, we can increment it by one. And every time it reaches zero, we should have another counter that counts the amount of times it hits zero. But then perfect. I suppose we have to take mountains into consideration then too, because we only want to count valleys, right?
Yeah, we are just going to be bothered about valleys. No counter, nothing with respect to mountains. We are not bothered about mountains at all. We are just bothered about only and only valleys.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay. So anybody else wants to contribute into this? Daniel, what do you think?
Okay, well, yeah, the idea is correct. I have to study the array with the first, if I see it's a U, I have to select a plus one, and no, I didn't, it's not, I'm not into it. I have to study it more.
Okay. Shaili, Shobhan, Pavan, what do you think? Kaushik, Jason, Gokul, Narinder, Sharon, what do you think? Anybody? Wants to give it a try? It's a very, very simple solution, guys. Very simple solution. So ideally what we need to do is we need to have two counters, okay? One counter is the counter, which is C-level counter. Basically, we need to check if we are covering one valley, then the C-level will be incremented by one. So that will be my final counter, that's there. But there has to be one more counter that is going to be deciding, called as altitude. Altitude? Counter? I don't really know why this is not incrementing. I mean, the font size, I don't know why it's not going up. No. So we will have a counter called as altitude, okay? We will have a counter called as altitude, which will be the counter that will be incremented or decremented depending on I am hitting a U or a D. I'm hitting a U or a D. So which means the altitude obviously starts with a zero level, which is this guy. If I get a D, the altitude will be minus one. It'll be changed to minus one. And then again, minus one, again, minus two, because it's going down, then minus three, right? So three U Ds, so I'm going down, and then I get a U, right? So the same guy will be now changed to, so minus two, minus one, minus two, minus three, and then that will be added with plus one, because I'm going up now. And then again, I'm going up now. Make sense? Yeah. I'm going up now. Yeah. And then again, I'm going up now. When I got into the entire minus one, minus two, minus three, and then when I completed the whole cycle, that's where I go and increment the sea level to one. Does that make sense? That's where I'm completing one cycle. I'm not bothered about what is happening in the mountains. So this is my one level. So now again you think that I am here in I'm here in the mountains. So I'll just go one level up, and then I'll go one level down. So it is going to come as zero, but then we have to check whether it is a mountain or not. So we will not consider the D's, you know, downward movement. So let me just get this done in the code. I have already completed this. So you see, this is the valley function, counting valley function. Okay, this function is having two attributes. One is called n, which is nothing but the total number of D and U's. And this is the whole string that you will get, okay? So what have I done? I have created a altitude integer, which is 80, and a valley counter called V, and that is 0. I have set both to 0. I have one single for loop. In the for loop, I am looping from 0 to less than N, okay? I++, perfectly fine. And then I am extracting character by character. So this is my character, right? This is each one of them are characters, right? So I have used a function called as charAt. This is a string, and you have a function, inbuilt function of string called charAt. So I'll say s.charAt of I. That means if I have the string as D, right? U, D, right? If I have that, then what will it do? It will take each and every one of the character and it will try to understand if the character is a U or it's a D.
So Vic, can I just ask, does N represent the amount of characters in S?
Yeah, that's right, yes.
Can I just ask though as well, do you have to add this DDDUUUD in as an array to this or?
No, it's just a string.
It's just a string, okay.
This is the function which is predefined, or not predefined, but this is the function structure.
Is the counting values knows DU or?
The function structure is already defined by the application HackerRank. Already giving you the function structure where you have a attribute of n and string.
Okay, I understand.
So with that, I have this n, which is basically total number of characters in the string. That's one thing. And second is, what I have to do is I have to pick up each and every character out of the string by using a inbuilt method of string called charAt. So string.charAt of I, because the loop is running, so string.charAt of I will give me one character in the loop for every time. So this is my char, ch. I'll get D first. It is going to check if D is the character is D or U. So if it is U, then it will do something. If it is D, it will do something. So what did it do? It says, if it is not U, then it will go and say A minus minus. So at minus minus, so it will be minus one. Again, the loop will go on for the next iteration. Again, it is a D, so it is going to be minus minus, so it is minus two now. And then again, one more time, it is minus D. So it is minus three now. Then it hits U, because then I have U. So it will simply increment altitude to plus one, right? If it is U. So now minus three will come to minus two, and minus two will come to minus one, and minus one will come to zero. That is my whole one C level. If my C level is zero, then I am saying that I have a valley counter. Complete the valley counter function below, and that's how it is. So I will be incrementing the valley. That's all pretty much about it. Everybody is understanding this part?
Yes.
All we have to do is we have to just count up or count down. And when I hit a valley, when I come back to the C level zero, then I am having the result here. So now if I run this in my run code. So obviously it is going to pass for this structure. So this is up. So you see this is up once and then down once. Okay. And then there are three, sorry, this is one up and one down. I don't know how did it get the output as one, because this is, let me see, why did it get one as output? That's strange. Let me check. This is the thing. So from the C level, I am going up once, I'm going down once, and then two downs, one, two, and then going up again, and then down again, and then two, two. Yeah, right. This is one valley, right? This is one valley with a small mountain inside. This is one valley. So yeah, we are good with that result. So we got that result. And then sample number, test case number two, which is a little bit complex. Definitely it is passing. So the test case is passing. On top of that, I will submit the code, which will test it against a very, very complex situation. So let's submit the code. So it's going to run the test against all the different scenarios. And let's look at some complex, very complex scenarios. Like if I go down, wow, look at this. Look at this structure. It's a 100,000, or not even 100,000, it's 1,000,000. 1,000,000 characters. And I am able to run my test against this kind of complex strings, which means my code is absolutely working fine. Right, this is also unlock. Yeah, again, 1,000,000. So I think, yeah. That's how it is. So everybody is happy with the solution, yes, no?
Yeah.
Yes.
Good.
Yeah.
Perfect. Perfect. I actually last week when I was solving the other problem about birthday candles, right? Where is the birthday candles? Yeah, this guy. I was expecting, I have actually sent a mail to you also, probably you haven't seen that. So what I was saying is that if you could write the solution of this birthday candle problem, which I did here, right? If you can write that solution in your own words about the algorithm, like how did we achieve this, right? It was also a very simple problem. So if you can write that in your simple words, that how did I actually completed the problem, then you know what will happen is you will be able to kind of register this into your mind. And then you will be able to train your mind towards handling complex issues like this. I really want you guys to, you know, to complete these HackerRank problems one after another, because these are real, real good stuff to learn. Something that will help you in your interviews, because these are the questions that will be given to you in interviews. Okay, so you must be solving that, then you must be then also, you know, training your mind towards handling a problem. I have another one to showcase to you. Maybe next week I will show this to you. It's a kangaroo jump. Okay, it's a kangaroo jump. What is a kangaroo jump? The problem is very simple. They are saying that both the kangaroos are jumping. Okay, the point is you have to figure out at what point these two kangaroos will meet each other. That's the question. Both of them are the kangaroo number one is jumping higher and longer. This guy is jumping smaller. Okay, but there could be a position. Basically, you have to basically tell that whether these two kangaroos will ever meet or not. That's it. Yes or no. So the sample in output is no, yes or no, depending on what is the calculation you are running against. So we will do this maybe next week, but it's really good and it really trains your mind very well. So that's with the HackerRank thing that I wanted to show you. I will obviously upload this problem or the solution in our assignments. You can take a look at it. Now let's get started with our usual course material. So class 5, okay. Class 5, what do we have? So in class 5, what we have discussed is, Java class, different type of class members, what is a class instance and how to access class members, discussing deeper understanding of Java objects, what are the methods and why do we need it, understanding scope, what is Selenium, understanding Selenium architecture, what is jar, installing and configuring Selenium. That's the part. So what is a class? Anybody wants to give us some understanding what is a class? You have already seen the video. Kaushik, do you want to try?
Sumit, can I try? Can I say?
Yeah, absolutely.
So a class is nothing but communication between objects and methods. To invoke the different methods into a class, class is using objects by creating itself on the class name.
No. What is class? Why do I need to use class? I mean, what is the main significance of class? You just said that, yeah, you can create an object and class will have method. That's fine. That's how the class works. But what is class? Why do I need a class? You have to think from a different perspective of live scenarios. Kaushik, do you want to try? Yes, no? Jason, do you want to try? I'm unmuting you. You can talk now. Have you seen the video, Jason? One minute, let me check. Can you also include HackerRank version? No, Kaushik, you're not audible. Let me try to unmute you one more time. Yeah, I have unmuted you. Oh no, yeah, you're unmuted. You can talk now, Kaushik. I'm not able to hear you at all. Guys, are you able to hear me? Yes, no?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, can you just come on audio and explain that? Kaushik. I'm not able to hear you, Kaushik. You're writing something in the chat, but can you come and say that? Okay, maybe he's having a problem with his mic. That's fine. Pinakshi, do you want to try? I'm unmuting you. Pinakshi, can you hear me? Have you watched the video, Pinakshi? I'm getting chats. You know, I can't hear you, Pinakshi. I don't know. I can't hear you. But I can't hear you, Pinakshi. Not sure why. Sharon, do you want to try? I'm trying to unmute you. Can you unmute yourself and try?
Hi. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you now, Sharon.
Classes are used for templates, so we can create instances.
Very good. So yes, you're absolutely right. So classes are basically a template that we will use And we will use a template when we are trying to compare it with a live situation. In this case, car is a class, and we have used car as a class because it is going to, it is reacting as a template, okay? A template that is having certain attributes and properties. When I say attributes, attributes are basically the variables. So string, brand, model, engine size, seating capacity, these are the attributes of a car. And properties will be that a car can start, a car can accelerate, a car can decelerate, a car can stop, right? That is the properties of a car. So you are creating a template, a car template, which is having certain attributes and certain properties, right? Then with that template, you will have the option to create multiple different car, which will also have the template, attributes. They will have the access to the attributes and the properties, but those attributes will have a value which will make them different from each other. Like you see, I have created a template, which is a car, and out of that, I have created three different car objects, which is Volkswagen, Aston Martin, and Suzuki. They have different brands, different models, engine size is different, seating capacity is different. They are absolutely different from each other. They are three different objects, different from each other because they have different values. That's one reason. And second reason is that these guys are also located in different memory location. So object number one, which is Volkswagen, is having a different address. This object is having a different address. Aston Martin is having a different address. Suzuki is having a different address in the JVM, which is why they are not having any connection between each other. And that's how they are different. That's how they are different, and that's how you're creating the object. How do you create the object? You just say car, Volkswagen equals new car. And Volkswagen is basically your object then. And then you can set the value into the Volkswagen using constructor, or you can do it by even accessing the variables as a part of getter setter. That's a different thing. So everybody is happy with the class explanation? Yes, no? I've explained it even better in the video, but I'm pretty sure that you have seen them. Daniel, yeah. Shiley, are you happy with that understanding of class?
Yes.
Good. Perfect.
My only question, can I ask?
Go on, please go on. Any questions, anytime, please go on.
You explain in details the garbage collector.
Right.
That comes out, you know, automatically.
Correct.
Well, I think it's the next slide, I think. Mm-hmm. In this example, let's say Suzuki, it's never gonna be erased. It's always gonna be in the heap memory, or after a while.
Yes. So garbage collector kicks in only if it finds that there is an unclaimed object somewhere present. That's where the garbage collector kicks in and clears that object out of the memory. But that happens automatically, and nobody, you don't need to really bother about it.
Exactly.
Yeah. And so this case, there is no trigger of garbage collector because they are all existing objects.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And those three objects, they're going to stay for the rest of the time of the program, I guess.
Exactly. As long as they are not, you know, pointing to each other, or you're not killing them separately, it will be there.
Okay, thanks.
Good. So that's with that. let's move on to the next one. How to create a class, a very simple thing. You just say public class car, and you create a class, as simple as that, with a flower braces. This is a public class that you have created that can be accessed from anywhere, anywhere in the project or outside of the project as well. So this is a public class car, and you created a class car which has no attributes or properties. What are different class members? Okay, I have already explained, but these guys are basically the variables, and they are the methods which are a class member. So in the car class, brand, model, engine size, sitting capacity, they are the attributes of the car class, and you can represent an attribute of the class by variables. Okay, and methods are nothing but your properties. So here I have said print brand name, but a right property would be starting the car, car start. That's the right property of a car because car can start. So methods are denoted by properties, and attributes are denoted by variables. And then we also have something called as constructors, which I have probably explained later on. I will talk about that in a minute. So what is an instance and how to create one, okay? So we can create an instance of a car using the simple keyword, which is new keyword. We say class car, car equals new car. So you just created a instance of the car, okay? When I create the instance of the car, obviously there is no value to it. I mean, if I really want to show this to you in my project, I will go in here. I will create a project, which is week two summary. Okay, and finish. And let me close all others. Okay, and in here, I will go ahead, create a package, and we'll say Java test. Right, and then what do? I go ahead and I'll just say a simple car class. So I'll just say car, that's it, nothing more than that. This car class will have attributes. What is attributes? String name, brand, string, model, int seats, right? These are my attributes of the car. So I'll just say attributes of the car, as simple as that. And then what do? I will basically try to create an object of the car out of this. So what I'll do is I'll go ahead and say new. I'll go for main method now. So test car, and just one second. Okay, so we have the main method now, and then what do? I'm going to create a car object. So I'll say car Mercedes equals new car. I'm not doing anything right now. I've just created a Mercedes object out of the car, right? Let's try to analyze this. I'll just put a breakpoint here in line number 9. So I will just put a breakpoint over here. That's it. So that I can inspect this object called Merc. And let's run this guy. So I'll say debug as Java application. And if I do that, then okay, I am stopping in line number 9. It is a It is a debug mechanism. I will explain that later on. I'm using a breakpoint to pause my execution so that I can inspect the existing elements and understand what's going on with it, right? So right now I have paused my execution line number 9. And then what do? I'm just going to inspect in Merc. If I hover my mouse on Merc, what do I see? I see something. I see that it is giving me some values for brand, model, and seats, but they are all null. So brand and model is a string, so they are giving the initial value as null, but the seats is 0 because it's an integer, so it's a 0. So how many ever objects I can create like that, I will always get the same state for the car. So I'll say Aston, and if I check with that guy, I will also get the same state. The Merc is also having the same state, and Aston is also having the same state. However, they are residing in two different space altogether, right? So the effect on Merc will never be affecting on Aston, as simple as that. So how do I set the Aston value or Merc value? It's very simple. I can say Merc dot brand, and I'll just say Merc, and I will just say here Aston dot brand. This is your Aston. Right? These are two of my objects, and they are entirely different than each other. If I now look at these guys, obviously right now nothing will happen because my execution is needs to be restarted. So I'm just restarting it. So now I have some value for Aston and for Merc. You can see that. I have a brand name now, right? They are totally different than each other, okay? So these are different instances that we have created. Every instance gets created with some initial state. For us, in the example, we saw the initial state was null and 0 for those values because there was no default value added to those variables. So we saw null and 0. And that is the initial state, okay? So let's move on. How to access class member, I just showed you. You can access a class member using a dot notation like this. And that's how we can pass on the value to it, or we can extract the value out of it, or we can set the value into it. So with a dot notation, you can do it. So these are called as reference variable ideally. This Volkswagen over here is a reference variable ideally. And these guys, the brand, model, engine size, these are actually the instance variable. A reference variable is basically the object, the Volkswagen object, a car object. And then the variables that you are trying to access inside the object of the car, Volkswagen, that guy is called as instance variable, which I have just mentioned there. Okay, it's just a different name, but ideally you're understanding what's happening. It's an instance, and this is the instance variable, as simple as that. So understanding Java objects and memory management. There are two types of memory sections available within the JVM. One is stack, another one is heap, okay? Stack holds all the methods are in execution, and heap stores instance objects. So for example, this is a heap memory. In the heap memory, I have created three different cars. The three different cars are residing in three different locations. Nobody is interacting with each other. They are three different locations, perfectly fine. The methods that are supposed to be executed, they are in this particular stack memory. Stack memory follows a rule called as LIFO. LIFO means last in, first out. The guy who is entered last will be executing first. Why? Because you see, the first call that happened was the main method, like this over here. The main method was called first, and then I created an object of Merc. And if the Merc is having an object called start engine, so the start engine is the next method after main method. So what will happen is the main method will execute or will exit later. First will exit is the start engine method. So for example, if I stop everything and if I say public void start engine, right? And I say sysout, and I will just say brand plus equals start engine. So I want this card to start the engine, starting engine, right? So if I call this method, so obviously I will be able to call this method from where? From the main method, obviously. This is my main method. So I can say Merc dot start engine. I can say that, no problem. So which means what? Which means this guy will be executed first, or it will be after execution, this guy will be exiting, or the execution will exit first in line number 10. After that, the main method will be executed. The exit of the main method will happen. First, this guy will be exiting. After that, main method will be exiting, right? So last in, first out, exactly what I'm trying to say here. The main method is the starting point, obviously. So it goes to the bottom in the stack. And then the immediate next one is the method print car name or starting engine, which is just next to the main method. So this guy will be executed first, and it will be, the execution will be completed first. Okay. So last in, first out, and then the main method will be executing. That's what LIFO is, right? Now, what I'm trying to say here is the garbage collector. The garbage collector will kick in if and only if this blue car object becomes what? Becomes null and void, or it becomes not null and void, it becomes, it points to another object. So what will happen with that is the space that this blue object was occupying, that space will be not there anymore. That space will be not there needed anymore. So garbage collector will kick in and will clear up everything. So for example, if I created a Merc brand, I created an Aston brand, and I'm going to create another brand, which is Audi. Perfect. So I'll just say Audi. Now for some reason, I'm not giving the right reason, but for some reason, if you wish to point Audi to Aston, for some reason, maybe there is a merger happened between Audi and Aston, I don't know. I'm just making up, right? If this happens, what will happen is you will say Audi equals Aston. Audi equals Aston. So the question is, you are saying the Audi is now Aston. So which means what's happening here is now the memory location that was reserved for Aston, the Audi object is now pointing to the Aston location. So they are having three different locations, like I've shown you here. Car, so Volkswagen, okay. Here I have given a different example in the video, but I'm saying, think about it. So this is a Audi, this is a Merc series, and this is a Aston. So now if Audi is pointing to Aston, what will happen is that this position, which was claimed by Audi earlier, will not be claimed anymore, because now RD object is anyway pointing to the Aston object. So it is pointing to the same location where Aston is residing. So this empty space that is there with for RD will be handled by garbage collector, which will automatically kick in and remove or clear that location. That's how the garbage collector works, right? So any doubts so far with whatever I have covered? Yes, no?
No.
Go on.
No, good.
Okay. Anybody else, guys?
Can I ask?
Yeah.
A quick question. Can you go back in the Eclipse in the program? Try to print out just to see. Now, yeah, after LD equals Austin, now print out, sys out brand.
Which brand? Audi brand or Aston brand?
No, this is.
How will you access brand without the object? Okay.
Aston
brand.
Yeah, that, let's see.
Aston brand. It's Aston. And it's Audi?
Aston.
Obviously. Aston never changed. And Audi? Is also Aston.
Oh, Audi is also Aston. Exactly.
Obviously. Because now they are pointing to the same guy.
Also, they both exist, but they're pointing at the same guy.
Exactly.
Austin.
Exactly. And there is nothing to do with RD information. The RD information is handled by garbage collector now. You understand?
Exactly.
Exactly.
Thanks. Perfect.
No problem. Perfect. Any other questions? I'm not hearing from Gokul, Victor, what's up, buddy? Come on, show your face, man.
I'm just listening.
Oh, you're just listening. Okay, all right, no problem. That's fine. You have any questions, Victor, or have you gone through the earlier assignments?
Unfortunately, I have not gone through any assignments, so I'm busy with work. But
okay.
The only question I have, as I said in the chat group, is I see sometimes you create classes, and sometimes when you write programs, you have constructors, and there's a way they just have the constructors that get me confused. That's what
is the difference between a class and a constructor, and how do we use them? That's the question that you have. Yeah, I will handle that. So class is a blueprint, which I have just explained. Constructor is something that we use to construct that blueprint to give an initial state to it. So if you remember, if I just showed you, I'm just going to make this guys without any information, right? So in the situation, if I put a breakpoint line number, I don't know, over here, okay? Or maybe over here, the last one, in the print statement. Okay, that's where I'm putting my breakpoint, perfectly fine. Now I'm going to do what? I'm going to trigger my debugging. So I'm landing here in line number 20. My execution is at pause, no problem. Now the question is, in this situation, if I go ahead and hover my mouse on any of these objects, let's do it. I did that. The information that I see is brand name, brand model, and seats. They are all showing some initial values, null, null, zero, right? Aston Martin, same. Audi, it's same. What does this mean? Why am I seeing null, null, zero for all the objects? The reason for that is the car template that I've created, it doesn't have any initial value for these attributes. In Java, when you're not giving any initial value, you're not explicitly defining any initial value to your variables, it takes up a default value. So for string, the default value is null. For int, the default value is zero, which is why you saw the value as null, null, zero. Now the question is this the right approach towards creating an object without providing some initial state of the object? Is it a right approach? The answer is no. You should not create an object. I'm not saying that you should not, but the best practice is to give an initial state to your object without being handled by some default information. So how can I do that? I can easily do that by creating a constructor. What I will do is I will say public car. And in public car constructor, what I will do is, in this car constructor, I will pass on some information. How do I pass on the information? I pass on the information in form of a string, br, string mod, and string seat, or int seat, st. Okay, what did I do? I have created a constructor which is exactly named same after the class name. The class is car. The constructor name is also car, okay? It is looking like a normal method in Java, but it's not. It doesn't have any return type, you can see. I am not giving any return type like void or something like that. I'm not doing it. So a constructor cannot return anything. I will explain that later on. But for now, you can see that I have created a constructor which is having the same name after the class name. They have some variables or attributes inside this constructor. Now what I can do is I can say brand equals br model equals mod, and what else we have? We have string, sorry, seats. Seats equals st, right? So I've given some, so what I'm doing is I'm going to use this constructor to set some initial values for the instance of the car which I will be creating. So now that I have this setup in place, now if I go back to my car class, it is immediately throwing me some exception. What is the exception it's throwing? It's saying that you have a constructor. Look at the exception. I mean, not an exception, but an error. It's saying the car, the constructor car without any attributes or arguments is undefined. It is saying that there is a car. It's also giving a suggestion. Add arguments to match the car constructor. String, string, int. So ideally, if I do something like this, then that will solve the issue. So here then I can say, I'm looking for an initial state of my object. I'll say Merc. I will say Mercedes, I don't know, C-class. Class C. C-class, sitting capacity, I don't know, 5. That's my Mercedes object created out of some values that will give your object an initial state. An initial state from where your execution will start off, an initial state you're trying to create. Here again, with Aston, I'll do the same thing. Aston, I don't know. I think it's Martin, I don't know. I'm just giving. Or what was the name of it? Zagato, yeah. The model is Zagato, right? 5-seater, and then Audi is, I'll just remove these lines over here. A brand name, okay. So brand name I will not access anymore because I have already done with the brand name. Here also I will not do it. Now what I'll do is I'll just use this guy in Audi, and Audi and A3 and five-seater maybe. So that's the situation with your constructor. So now in this case, what we can do is we can easily go back to our car class, make these guys private. Why I want to make them private? The reason for making your attributes private, and which is a best practice, is you don't want anybody to access this attribute and change it just like that. You want someone to create a constructor or create a proper object of test car or car class, and then you can access it, like the way I'm doing it. So what I did is, I simply removed all my existing code, which was here. I have now an initial state of my cars. Okay, I'll just put this out for now here, so that I can show you what's going on, right? And let's run the program, and then let's see what happens. So test car, line number 18, I'm landing in line number 18. And then if I hover in Merc object, just see what happens. A Mercedes having an initial state, it's having a value, Mercedes, C-class and five-seater. These information is going inside the class as a form of attributes through the constructor. So constructor class is the blueprint, right? And constructor is the option that you will use to construct your object that is derived out of that blueprint. Am I making sense, Victor?
Yeah.
Good. Everybody else understand this? Any questions?
Yep.
Everyone else, please?
Okay. So I have two ways to initialize my car, let's say, with constructor.
It's always the right thing to initialize your car or any object for that matter if it is needed. It's not always, but if it is needed. So for me, in this case, it was needed that I should give an initial state to my car class object, which is why I use a constructor to send some information inside the car class and set that value as a part of the attribute. But it's not always needed. It's not always required. So for example, if you remember my previous class there, let me show you over here. Let me see. So for example, where is my driver factory? That's my driver factory. Okay. So you see, I am saying WebDriver driver equals new Chrome driver. This Chrome driver is a class. This Chrome driver is a class that doesn't need any initial value for its object to be created. That's the reason the constructor area is empty. It's not that every time you need it, it depends on your requirement. So for myself, in this requirement, I wanted to initialize my car class with certain information, which is why I introduced constructor and I use it there. It doesn't mean that in each and every program, you will also have to follow the same structure. If you need it, that's where you go and you use constructor. If you don't need it, you will not use it. These things will be much more clearer when we start, you know, completing more and more assignments and you go to the advanced topics of in this module, you will understand where to use what, right? So that's how it is. Sometimes it is also possible that with the help of a method, you can send some information inside the class. That's highly possible, right? You don't have to use a constructor. That's highly possible. So similarly, you know, you will keep on using different options that I show you, and you will get to know where to use what. Is that clear, Daniel?
Okay, yeah, thanks.
Good, good. So that's with that. What are methods and its uses? Well, I told you methods are nothing but properties. You can use method so that you can execute a statement over and over again. You are just basically supporting do not repeat yourself principle by using creating methods. If you are anticipating that this particular statement that you are writing will be used later on in the program somewhere, you can go ahead and create a method out of it. And all you have to do is you have to call that method n number of times. You will not have to write the same thing over and over again. You just have to call the method as many as number of times you want. That's it. That's the method. And that's how methods are used. Okay. Understanding scope, a very, very important thing to understand. Guys, you have to understand that the information which is exactly placed here in this portion of the class, which I mean over here, in my class car, okay? So the information that I am putting it here in this portion is called as global scope. A global scope for these variables. What do I mean by that? I mean, these variables that you are defining over here, you are defining over here, will be or can be accessed around all the methods and constructors in the same class. So this guys over here that you're creating can be easily accessed under any number of methods or constructors you are creating inside this car class, because they are defined in the global space. If you are declaring a variable inside a method like this, int number, I'm just saying, okay? Int number equals zero, I'm just saying, right? That's a variable that you created inside the method start engine. This variable is a local variable to the start engine method, which means nobody else will have ever access to this variable from this method. This variable is pretty much local to itself, and nobody else will have an access to it. However, this guys over here, which are defined in this section of the class, are global methods, global variables or attributes that can be accessed anywhere in the class by any other members. That's the difference between local and global scope, right? That's what exactly I have mentioned, and I have already shown that to you in the video. Any questions so far, guys? Any questions? Yes, no, maybe. Any questions? Okay. Okay, perfect. So let me check, okay. So that is the first class that I wanted to cover. What about the next one? I have in class 6. Let me quickly go through it because I had to spend some time with the assignments. Okay, so then we have some concepts to get cleared. What is the concept? What is Selenium, okay? Well, Selenium is basically a very simple thing. It's an open source tool that will help you to interact with a web page, a web application. You can perform any kind of interaction, click, send keys, or you want to drag and drop text or a file to the application or whatever. Any kind of web page interactions can be handled with Selenium. It's an open source tool. Okay, it was built by this guy, Jason Huggins, when he was working with ThoughtWorks, okay? So we basically have three different flavors of Selenium. One is the IDE, Selenium IDE. It's a record and play tool, basically for Firefox browser. It's just a record and play tool. It doesn't have any flexibility, and nobody uses that. Okay, it's just there for someone to understand how automation works. The second one is Selenium WebDriver. That is something that we will learn in our whole course. We will learn how to interact with each and every object using Selenium WebDriver. And third is the Selenium Grid. The grid is a very crucial tool to understand in today's time, because we want to execute our test cases in the minimal amount of time. So with using Grid, I can run thousands of test cases in parallel. Okay, I can achieve parallelization, and I can run them parallelly from the same machine, and you will see that how fast your entire test case gets executed, or test suite gets executed. So we will learn about that in the later stage. Selenium Grid, okay, how Selenium works. So Selenium basically works because Selenium creates a REST API endpoint, okay? Basically, it is a listener, all right? It's a listener to any kind of events that gets fired from the test. It listens to it, and then it works as a mediator between the browser and the test, which will simply pass on the information to the browser to perform any action. So for example, a test is having an option or scripted to click on a button. So when a test is clicking, or when a test is trying to click on a button, this instruction gets transmitted from the test to the web driver using a protocol called as JSON wire protocol. What is JSON wire protocol? JSON is basically a data type, a type in which information are being transmitted from one end to the other end. Okay, so JSON wire protocol means the click event that is being fired from the test is converted to a JSON formatted data, which is something that our web driver will understand, and it will intercept and then simply pass on that information to the browser so that that action can be taken place. Action can be taken place on the browser. Once that action is taken place, is completed, browser will send back the information in form of a response code, like 200. 200 is a response code that will be sent back by the browser, and then that will be sent back to the test. That's how the test will know that the interaction that it is trying to perform is performed properly or not. If the interaction is, if the status code is something else, a 400 or 300 or not 300, 400 and above, that's where your test will give you an exception saying that this has failed because of so-and-so reason, right? So that's how Selenium WebDriver works. It works as a mediator or a postman, which will simply pass on the information from one end to the other end, but it uses a protocol called a JSON wire protocol, and that's the architecture that you should be ideally explaining it to anybody who wants to understand what is Selenium WebDriver, okay? It's a REST API endpoint. Okay, it's a REST API endpoint. What do I mean by that? Is this. So for example, I'm going to Expedia.com, right? And in Expedia.com, if I go and if I open my developer console and go to the network tab, and I will remove all these calls over here. Okay. I will just say some information. say France or Paris. Paris. Check-in date, I don't know, maybe June. Checkout. Okay. I will remove all these calls and perform a search. As soon as I do a search, what is happening here is that hundreds of calls are being made to kind of a server. That server is processing this information and giving back a result that you can see in your screen. Okay? So I actually have to see that the call that I have made. What call was that? So you see, I have made a call over here called hotel search. Okay? If I open this call, and if I try to understand this call, what is happening? What's happening here is I'm calling an endpoint. This is a URL. This is a endpoint or a URL, which is coming out of Expedia. I am trying to perform a HTTP request. The method that I'm trying to use is a get method. I will explain about this more when I'm going to teach you about API testing. But for now, you understand that I'm trying to get some information out of this URL. So I am performing a method called get, and I'm passing some information to this URL. What is this information? You see, the information that I'm passing to this is something like, destination Paris, latitude, longitude, region ID, start date, end date, rooms, adults. These are the information I am passing to the endpoint. The data that I'm passing to the endpoint right now, I'm passing it as a part of query string parameters. Okay. In some application, you will see that they are being passed as a JSON formatted data, like the one I showed you, right? You're passing information. Here it is a query string parameter, but in many cases you will see it's a JSON string body. And I will show you when I teach you API testing. But for now, you understand that what am I doing is I am passing some information to the application, and the application is responding back with a status code called 200. So similarly, our good old WebDriver is also, when you are instantiating WebDriver, it is opening up an endpoint or a URL for us, which you and me cannot see. But that URL is waiting to serve some requests that are being sent by the test in form of a JSON wire protocol. And then WebDriver is simply sending that information to the browser. Am I making sense? Whatever I just said, does that make sense, guys? Yes, no?
Yeah.
Yes.
Good. So that's how your data is being transformed, or that's how Selenium WebDriver works, and you are able to interact with your object. So let's understand a jar. Jar is nothing but Java archive file. I've already shown that to you earlier, I believe so. So in this, if I open the reference library, this is the jar, Selenium jar, where I have thousands of packages. Every package is having some compiled classes, and that's how I am able to, when I'm configuring my project with the reference library, like a Selenium jar, I'm able to access all these classes. They're public classes, some of them are public classes, I'm able to access them, okay? So I spoke about the jar file because obviously I need to install or configure Selenium into our project. So that's why. All right. Understanding the jar, that's fine. Let's move on to the next one. Installing and configuring the project. I have already shown this to you. You can just go to this particular location, selenium.dev, download the jar file and add it to your project. Now the question to everybody here, everybody is able to install and configure Selenium? Yes, no? Give me a shout, please. Everyone.
Yes.
put it in the chat if possible. Jason say, Shalini, Kaushik, Narendra. How about others? Gokul, Shobhan, Gokul, Tom D, Victor. Okay. Daniel. Okay. Okay. Sharon. Okay. Perfect. That's good. That's good. So we have the installation done. And that's the end of class 6. Let's go back to the next one, which is class 7. In class 7, what do I have? Okay, understanding HTML and basic structure, very, very important stuff to understand. What is HTML? Guys, HTML is the structure that is given to your web page. So from a different angle, you can think that HTML is the foundation that you will be building when you're building your house. Okay, all the beams, all the columns, they are basically your structure, your windows, your empty window frames. Okay, those are your structure that you are building as a part of your house, right? So that is same exactly like HTML. This will give you a very bare bone structure of the system, of the application, where you have body, we have paragraph, you have anchor, you have divs, you have hundreds of things, right? So you have to understand. So more and more you deal with, more and more you open up your developer tools, you will be able to understand the structure better. So if I go to the developer tools, under elements tab, leave the network tab over here, elements tab, you see, this is my HTML structure. My HTML starts with a top root HTML, and then I have two sections. One is head and body. This structure that you see here, HTML, head, body, right? This whole thing is called DOM, document object model, a particular model that is being followed by all the developers around the globe to create a HTML structured web page. As simple as that, right? So in the head section, you have some information to be supplied. Gokul, you are not mute. Okay, let me mute you back. That's fine. So what is happening here is in the head structure, you have hundreds of information that is supplied. What are these? These are scripts. You can see script tags. The scripts, basically JavaScript. So JavaScript is the guy who will give action to your web page. Who will give action? So when you're clicking on a button, right? You're clicking on a button, something is happening, right? You see something is happening. Who is taking care of that? JavaScript is taking care of that action. So you will be designing that when you click on a button in your page, something should happen. That is something is done by JavaScript. And you see any web page you open up in the header section of the page, you will see a lot of JavaScript calls. There are hundreds of JavaScript files located somewhere in their website. Okay, and if I open this up, I don't know if I'll be able to open this up or not, but let me try. I don't think they will allow me to open this. Yeah, it's there. It's there. I'm able to open it. So this is basically a script, a JavaScript. It's not formatted properly, so it's showing very stupid. But anyways, these are hundreds of JavaScript functions. You can see return. These are JavaScript functions which are being placed in this particular file. And these files are then linked into the application, right? So JavaScript will give the action to the web page. HTML is basically the structure, right? So now what do I do? And then CSS is there to basically give you the look and feel. These colors, right? They are all coming from CSS. There are three different components of any web page: HTML, JavaScript, and CSS. So now that you understand HTML structure, HTML tree looks like this. The main window is the window object. Then we have HTML, then head and a body. In the head, you will see title, scripts, all those things goes to head. In the body, you will actually see the body of, or you will actually see the components that you are actually interacting with in the page will be there inside the body, which means images, H1 tags, paragraphs, divs, they're all will be a part of the body tag, or body tag, yeah. Now, understanding browser dev tools, I've already shown this to you. We have elements where you will be able to inspect the element of, or the object of a particular component. XPath is what we will be using in a great scale. I will show that to you in a while. And then we have different tabs like console, we have services, we have performance, and I think I've explained them well in the video itself. Really don't want to do it again. Understanding HTML tags, all right? There are different tags that you should be well versed with. One is the anchor tag, which is basically for your, links in the page. Then we have input tags. Input tags are basically to get the data from user in form of a text box. Input tag could be also a button. Okay, I've shown that to you, I believe, in the video. If not, I'll show you later on. Input tag can be changed to work as a button by changing its attributes, okay? And then select tag is basically a drop-down. So all you have to understand ideally, guys, is that a web page, so for example, let me go back to my xpd.com again. If I open this up, all I have to understand is, if I click on this guy and say inspect, it is leading me to something in the developer tools. What is this guy? It is an input tag information. And you see, this is the tag, the guy which is having an arrow bracket. That's the input tag. You're opening it and you're closing it at the very end. Where is my input tag getting closed? Input tag. Input tag, I think it's getting closed over here. Yeah, that's the input tag. That's getting closed over here, right? So that's the input tag. Inside input tag, you see many more information. So there are two components to a tag or an element, web element. One is the tag, which is this input in our case. Let me increase this size. Sorry. Okay. So there are two components to a particular web element that you're trying to interact with. This is a web element, this text box, you want to interact with it. So any web element will have two components. One is a tag. Another one is the attribute. Attributes are these guys, area autocomplete. That's an attribute, okay? Then data dest. I don't know what is it. I'm not working for Expedia. I don't know what is it, but I can say that there is an attribute, okay? Then you have something called as what? Data LOB. Then you have something called as ID, hotel destination, HP hotel, that's the ID. So these are your attributes, ideally, right? These are your attributes, and input tag is the tag. So the combination of both of these together basically becomes a web element that you want to interact with. As simple as that. So we will understand in the later part of the program how to write your own XPath that will lead you to this particular element. Right now, probably what you can do is you can just right click on this element and say copy, and then say copy XPath. Okay, whatever the copy you did. So for example, if I just say control, this is the XPath you got out of it. Okay, it will definitely work for you right now, but this will be probably not a stable XPath. And later on I will explain why, and I will show you how to write your own XPath well. Okay, so that's the situation. So HTML components are built with tags and attributes combined together, okay? Now, moving on, Understanding HTML attributes, I just told you what exactly it is. Finding an element, we will find an element using this option called driver.findElement. Driver basically is the web driver object that we will create. Web driver driver equals new driver. That's the object that we will create. And find element is a method that we will use. That method is coming from Selenium library because we have integrated the Selenium library into our project. So obviously find element will be, I will be able to access find element. And the next thing that we want to use is by.id. ID is, this is the element. This is the value that we have found. Dot send keys. And in the send keys, you are passing the value that you want to pass on, right? So driver.findElement by ID dot send keys, and the text will send the information inside the text box using JSON wire protocol, which I have explained earlier. So that's the basic statement towards finding an element and towards sending some information to a text box. Similarly, you can perform a dot click. You can perform any information. So for example, in our program, the one which I have here. So for example, test driver. So I can, okay, I'll just use it here itself. So you have to understand that you can create an object like this. You can say web element ELE equals to driver dot find element by xpath or link text or whatever or ID whatever dot ID, right? And this is your ID. I'm just giving some dummy ID. So ideally what is happening here is you are creating, you're finding an element, you're trying to find an element in the web page that is having an ID called so-and-so. And this guy over here is basically returning back a web element. How do you know that? How do you know what exactly is the return type of a method? This is the findElement method. How do you know the return type of a particular method? If you hover on top of find element, you see the first information over here is web element. Do you see that? So it means that any method that you're trying to interact with, if you hover on top of it, the first word will basically give you the information that what exactly is the return type of the method. So find element is returning a web element. So I can say web element ELE equals to driver.findElement. And then I can say ELE dot click clear or ELE dot click or ELE dot send keys. Because all these methods dot clear, dot click, dot send keys, they are part of web element object. They are part of web element object. That's the reason you're able to say ELE dot clear, ELE dot click, or ELE dot send keys. In a shorter form, I will not use this. I will directly say driver dot find element by something ID and dot click. You understand the situation here. This guy is giving me the web element. Web element is having the access to dot click method, so I can say the whole thing in one line. Make sense to everybody? Yes, no, guys?
Yeah.
Yes.
Good. Perfect. So now what do I do is I'm going to remove them. And let's see what else we have. Okay. Now we have find element and inspecting element. Inspecting element, I have probably shown this to you in in the page. It's a, and I have shown you probably how to copy the XPath. I'm showing you again, you probably want to work with any kind of elements during the assignment phase. All you have to do is you have to right click on it until you learn how to write your own XPath. You just right click on the object, say inspect. That'll open up your developer tools. And I'll also point to the right element. If you hover your mouse on the element, you will see that your item in the right-hand side of the page gets highlighted. If I move my mouse to something else, it's not highlighted anymore, right? This guy is highlighting, so which means it is the right element. All you have to do is you have to right-click on this guy, say copy, and say copy XPath. Copy XPath, that's it. When you say copy XPath, it basically copies the XPath, and then you can use it in your test. During the assignment phase, you can use this option until I teach you the XPath, right? But this is not the right way to do it. We will learn the right way. Okay, creating a basic scenario for test automation. I think that was it for 5, 6, 7 class, a summary. I want you guys to tell me if you guys are happy with 5, 6, 7 class summary. Yes, no? Any question, any doubts I can answer? I'm getting some chats. Let me handle that. Does it matter which attribute you use or mainly XPath? No, okay. So attribute is, I just explained, attribute is additional information added along with the tag, right? So that whole combination of an attribute and the tag is basically the element that you're trying to interact with, Tom, okay? XPath is the mechanism to find that element in the page, which I will teach you later on. XPath is the mechanism or the strategy that you will use to find the element in the page. That's how your, that's a difference. I hope you understand. Is that clear, Tom?
Yeah, cool.
Good, good. All right. I think everybody is giving. Okay. What is the presentation? I think I have handled all the questions. Everybody's happy with 5, 6, 7. Perfect. Next, all I have is to go through the assignments that we have given to you for 5, 6, 7, and we have tried to complete them. So the first assignment is in here. I will upload the assignment as I do. So this is my week 2, 5, video 5, video 1. Okay, assignment number 1. Well, all it was required is to create a rectangle class and define the length and breadth properties. Okay, different rectangle objects are different from each other by setting different length and breadth. That was the requirement. And here is the test rectangle class where different rectangles are created, a geometry box, a floor mat, a Xiaomi phone. They have different size, they have different length, different breadth, and that's how they are different from each other. Also, they are located in different locations in the JVM, so they are different. That's the first assignment, very simple. Next assignment is, let's see, what is the assignment? Create a car class and create different global variables, top speed, and I have shown this to you today itself. So brand, top speed, the same situation. In the test run, you are creating a Benz. Okay, this is a runtime polymorphism. Sorry, guys. Okay, let me explain this. I have already explained this, but I will explain this again. So I've created a car class, guys. This is having some variables, some attributes, and some properties. Perfectly fine. Now, I also have another class, which is Benz. Benz is another class, and I want my Benz class to be of type car class. It's an is-a relationship. Benz is a car. You're trying to create a is a relationship, right? Benz is a car. So what I can do is I can simply achieve this is a relationship using extends keyword. Okay, I'm saying Benz extends car. So it means that Benz is of type car, right? So once I do that, what will happen? In the car class, you can see there is a constructor. There is a constructor. This constructor is expecting some argument, which is the string. And this string is nothing but the brand name. And then you say BR equals to brand name. You're setting the value inside the constructor. So the value which will come inside the car constructor will be set inside the variable brand, as simple as that. So when you are extending your subclass, your child to the parent, and if the parent is having a constructor already in place, then a child should also follow the same structure. A child should also have a constructor, something like this. So it can be done easily by saying, I'll take out the string. I'll just say Benz over here. So it's a default constructor. There is no arguments I'm passing. All I will do is here in the super is, I will pass the value called Benz. That's it. Because super is the keyword using which I am allowed to transfer the data, this Benz information, inside the car class. The car class. So basically using the super keyword with a bracket like this, you're calling the constructor of your parent. Am I making sense? You're calling the constructor of your parent from the subclass. This is a subclass. This is the parent class. So the parent class constructor, I am trying to create, or I'm trying to construct my parent class from the subclass. That's why I said super in brackets Benz. Can you guys tell me if you understood this? That's a very important concept to understand. Yes, no?
What is the question? Yeah, why is the reason to create a subclass?
Okay. So you have, so the answer to your question is right here in the car class itself. Let me go in here. So you see, I have a car class. The car class is having these three methods: get brand, set top speed, get top speed, right? I already have created a car class. Is it not better that I can create a subclass and I extend my subclass to a parent class, and automatically by doing that, the subclass will have access to all these properties on its own? You understand? So you are again achieving do not repeat yourself program. You are trying to use a smarter way towards using your parent class information and then just create an object out of it. So you see, in the Benz, what I have is, I have simply extended to car. The car class is having three properties. They are get brand, set top speed, get top speed. If I simply remove this section right now, just for the example, I'm removing this section right now. And just give me one quick second. Yeah. So, okay. So now in this scenario, if I am just removing, commenting out all my existing methods, and if I try to interact with Benz, so can I do something like this? Okay, I will have a method over here. For example, public void running.
Sorry, if I may say something. Yeah. So what I understand about using extensions to extend a class is like you have a class which has these methods, okay? And then you have a child class and you extend, you want to inherit all the methods in the parent class. And also in that child, you want to create additional methods which the
true, class. True, exactly. That's what I'm trying to show them.
Yeah.
I'm trying to show them exactly the same thing. So I'll just put a method here and I will say Ben's running at high speed. So let's look at this option now, okay? So I have created a Ben's class. I've extended to car class. That's one thing, okay? This Ben's class is having its own method called running at high speed. Car is having its own methods called get brand, set top speed, and get top speed, right? I have all of them here. Now what do? I simply go back to my test runtime polymorphism. I will first and foremost comment this out. And I will just say, I'm just creating a Benz object, see? I'll say Benz equals new Benz. Correct? I just created a Benz object, perfect? Once I created a Benz object, what I will do is, you see, if I hit Benz dot, I'm having access to get brand, get top speed, set top speed, and also my own method. So get brand, Benz dot set top speed, something, some value, 100. Benz dot get top speed, Benz dot running at high speed. So what does this mean? It means that these three methods are not a part of Ben's class. Ideally, it's a part of the parent class of Ben's, but I'm still able to access it. Similarly, running at high speed is also a method part of Ben's class only, and I'm able to access that as well. So that's why you need to have an inheritance in place, because you want to have a situation where you don't want to write things already been written there and it's present. You can simply extend to the same class and use it in your own fashion. Am I making sense, Daniel?
Yes, great, thanks.
Is it basically just say you've created a class and then you want to create a class that has those attributes plus or has those methods plus and other methods? So instead of creating like a whole new class, you just have the parent class plus a new method within the new class.
Exactly. That makes sense. Yeah. You don't want to spend time in creating the same methods which are already being present. You can simply extend to the primary class and you can use those methods by its own, and then you can have your own method like the one I just showed you, and then you have it. So by this situation, when you have created this extension between your child, which is Benz, and your parent, which is car, when you have created this extension or relationship, this relationship is called a is-a relationship. When you're saying extends, Benz extends car, you're basically saying that Benz is of type car. Benz is of type car, right? And once you said that Benz is of type car, then you have another option, which is basically runtime polymorphism. What is it? So you can then write something like this. Let me remove it. Because Benz is of type car, So I can basically write something like this now. I can say that, I can say that car Benz equals new Benz. You understand? Earlier, what I was doing is something like this. If you remember, all I was doing is something like this. I was saying car Benz equals new car. This is what I was doing earlier. I was saying car Benz equals new car. I was creating an instance of a reference variable of car by creating an object of car. That's what I was doing earlier. Now I'm doing something else. I'm saying car Benz equals new Benz. Why am I doing this? This is called as runtime polymorphism. Runtime polymorphism. Why am I doing this? I'm able to achieve this because Benz is of type car. That is the reason why I'm able to achieve this. What is the benefit of this? The benefit of this is that obviously Benz will have the access to the Benz object that you created is having access to the brand, not brand, sorry, the method coming out of the set top speed, say 100 or 100, Benz dot get top speed. I'm getting the access to that as well. And also I have the access to my own method. No, sorry, I will not have the access to my own method. Yeah, so I'm not going to have the access to my own method. I'm going to have the access to just my Benz methods that are a part of cars class. By doing this, I am having access to only the methods that are part of my cars class. Why am I all saying this? There is a bigger picture to all that I am showing you here. And the bigger picture is this. So for example, I'm creating another class. New class. And the class is Audi, which is exactly same as your Benz. It extends to car, right? Extends to car. Add a constructor. So I'm adding a constructor. The constructor that I have added here for Audi will be just supplying the value Audi like we did for Benz, AUDI, Audi. Perfect. That's pretty much about it. Now, just a minute. You're creating an instance, right? Which is extends car. You're creating an instance. Yeah, I'm creating an instance of the car class pointing to the subclass. That's what I'm doing. So, okay. Now I am creating two classes. I have a Benz, I have an Audi. I have a Benz, I have an Audi. Why this runtime polymorphism really helps? Why is this very important to learn? So what I will do is, I am just going to comment out everything over here. I'm going to say something. I'm going to say string car name equals Audi. Okay. Depending on user input, depending on user input, you want to dynamically create the instance of an object depending on the user input, right? What do I mean by that? I've given a name called Audi to the car, okay? I can do something like this. I can say car equals null for right now. I'll just say car equals null for right now. And then I will say if car name equals dot equals, it's a string, so we will use dot equals method. Car equals, if it equals Audi, then I want to create an object like car equals new Benz, sorry, new Audi. You understand how my object is getting created dynamically depending on the user input. It is getting created dynamically depending on the user input. So I said, this is my user input. User is saying that I want to create an object of Audi at runtime. So I am saying that I will not write car equals new Audi or car equal new Benz separately. I'll put this into a if else statement, and in the else, if car name equals to Benz, car name equals to Benz. Okay, then what do? I say, you see that? I'm creating the object depending on the user input. This is the reason why runtime polymorphism is useful. See, depending on your user input, you are creating respective object. Now what do? I will say car dot set top speed 100 or 120. Car dot get top speed. I'll have to print this value. So sys out. Okay. And then I'll say car dot get brand. So I'll put this get brand first. Sys out. Now just see what happened. I created the object dynamically depending on my user input. I've written some statement which will then work for any type of object that is being created over here. So it is Audi now. Now if I run this program, just see what happens. I get all the values out of Audi only because here the brand name is this, set top speed is 120, get top speed is 120. I got it for Audi. Now, if I'm making this Benz, and if I run the same program, it is coming for Benz. You understand what's happening. Depending on the user input, you are dynamically changing the object creation. This is called as runtime polymorphism, because depending on the user input, you are dynamically choosing what type of objects to be created. And depending on that, you are able to execute the respective methods. Daniel, are you understanding this?
Yes, great. It's okay. Very interesting, yes.
Yeah. Anybody else? Everybody else there?
Yeah, it makes sense.
Yeah, we're good.
Good. Perfect. Okay. So now what? Now we will just see about the, so I think that is assignment number two. Assignment number three was, number four, yeah. Number three. Let me check this. Okay, I think it is also very similar. I'm just creating an employee with some information over here, name, qualification, salary, and some properties. And then in this method, I'm just creating different type of employees. It's quite same, so not to worry about that. Then we have assignment three, create a class and create a method within, generate five random number and assign them into the method. Yeah, right. So you just have to,
Hi, Savik.
Yeah, tell me.
This is very basic understanding. And if you can see down to that one, I mean, top to that assignment 3_2.
Yeah. Okay.
That is the actual one. This is just.
Right. Makes sense. So yeah, so there is a method that has been created over here called getRandomInteger. Okay. It is giving a maximum value, a minimum value. And this is the method that has been used. Math is a part of Java class itself. Java lang math. It's a part of Java package itself. So math.random into this formula you have to use, maximum minus minimum plus minimum. So this will basically give you the random value within a range. So you give a range, say 50 to 100. So it gives you a random value between 50 to 100 all the time. So that's the method, get random integer. And then that random integer is now being applied towards passing the value inside this array. And then you're printing that array. That's pretty much about it. It's a very simple method. So that's that. Assignment five, what is this? Define in your own words about Selenium, Selenium IDE, Selenium WebDriver, and Grid. I think everybody has already got this. So I will really not bother about this one. Week two, video six, assignment one, all right. How to make use of DevTools by verifying performance of a small site. I have shown that to you already. It's very simple. You go back to your expedia.com. You go to performance tab here. I will just actually restart my expedia.com. I'll open this up. And if I just say record, and you suppose want to perform some action like this, and it is performing some operation back in the backend, right? So this is your profiling that is happening. User profiling is happening. And once it is done, you just stop your recording. And once you stop the recording, it basically gives you a performance metrics, like a report, how your application performed during this phase. So depending on what metrics Expedia.com really considers, they will see if the performance of the application is good at any given point or not. So it's really not something that you need to really know. I just wanted to give you this understanding because you should understand what are the different tabs you have here in this DevTools. That's the reason I wanted to give you this information, but it's okay. It's taking some time to process. I will come back to it in a moment. So then I have assignment number two. What are the various versions of Selenium WebDriver we are aware of? I think we already have Selenium 2.53, which was a very old one. Now it is Selenium 3.14. So those are the different stuff. I think he has already mentioned, Pavan has already mentioned the information over here. You can take a look at it. Assignment number three, how to install configure Selenium WebDriver. You have done that already. Assignment number four is basically name few classes you know in Selenium WebDriver. So obviously for now, you know about the Selenium WebDriver having some classes like Firefox, Edge, Chrome, Selenium, Math. I didn't know this is existing, but it's good. Selenium is having a method called, or a class called, or a package called math, inside which there is some classes here. So in the Selenium package, there are so many different classes that you can see. Alert is one class that we will talk about later on. Then we have capabilities that we'll talk about that later on. Many of these things, you can take a look at it. Just for your understanding what you're getting into, it's good that you can, you should spend some time with this packages to figure out what is there inside. Then we have five, assignment five, create an instance of the object, how to make use of Selenium class. Yeah, exactly. How to make use of class in Selenium WebDriver into your project. So you have to create an instance of the WebDriver in order to make use of it in your project. Assignment six is, Pavan, can you explain what is this? I don't really remember. Are you there, Pavan?
I'm here. It is just a basic architecture of launching an application. So in core, under core, under tests, you're creating a driver factory class, a test driver, okay, which is done here.
Okay.
Driver factory under core.
Yeah.
And a test driver under tests, wisdom QA under tests.
Okay.
Just a basic architecture to launch an application.
Right, right. Okay. So what he's done is he has created a class called as driver factory, and he's keeping it inside a package called core. Inside this class, the whole responsibility of this class is to just create a web driver object, and that's it. Get driver is a method which will get you the relevant web driver, whether it's a Chrome driver or a Firefox driver. It will just give you back a driver object. That's what the main reason of this particular class. And then you have a class called Wisdom QA that is extending to driver factory, extending to this driver factory class. And then by doing that, what will happen is obviously this driver factory that you have used, you can directly call the method called getDriver. You have called the getDriver in the browser name, whatever the browser name is, it will get you the Chrome driver out of it. And then you can say .get method, and you can basically call this wisdomqa.com. And this wisdomqa that you have created is now will be used towards, in the main method, you can create an object of wisdomqa, and then you can pass on the browser name like this. It's a constructor. So you can pass the value as Chrome, which will eventually get the driver, it will get the URL, and it will launch for you. Everybody understand this structure? Have you guys done the same thing, or you're still yet to complete this section?
That's a really cool way of doing it. I didn't do that. I didn't create the driver factory class. I just had a main method with a Chrome driver in it, and then I got went chrome.get, and I also set the property to webdriver.chrome.driver.
Perfect.
Yeah, I did
perfect.
The same. I didn't create a class either.
But this guy will definitely be a better. You can look at the structure here, and then you can implement the same thing in your project and then see what happens. It's a very simple thing. You can just create a separate package called core. Inside that, create a driver factory class. And then you just have another class over here called Wisdom QA, using which you can get the driver factory method. And then you can have another class called main method, which will be there to initialize your Wisdom QA class. So you can do that. Right, a very simple structure. The architecture is given. You can take a look into it.
I have that allow you to do so. Say if you were to write a test case for like different browsers, would it allow like the same test case for different browsers? Kind of, is that how that would help?
Yeah. So what you can do is you can then just change this Chrome to Firefox, and then it will launch it for Firefox. That's it.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, this is a very, very simple structure, guys. I mean, I will really not consider this to be a decent structure also. It is just for you to kind of get started, because this structure that you are seeing, you are just getting into framework understanding. Framework is nothing but creating a structure, okay? So we will create really, really complex structure, which will make more sense when we are in the right place. But for now, it is a very simple structure to get started with. And Pavan, very good job in this. Thank you. So assignment number 7, what is this? Fill in the blank, okay? This links direct to our site. So it's a href, obviously, yeah. It's a href. Answer is href, obviously. Links are always having, any anchor tag will always have this attribute called href, which will be pointing towards a actual valid link. So href is an attribute of the anchor type, anchor tag. That's for sure. We have assignment number 8, where we have some headings. Okay, it's just talking about different headings, the h1, h2, h3, h4, h5. In different heading type, you see that text is getting changed. The look and feel is getting changed. So that's the headings. Then what else we have? This is week 2, rectangle. I think I've covered that. I think we have covered all of it. Video 5. Okay. Video 6. Video 7. Video 7 is the same thing which we are talking about, actually. Xperia test. Okay. I think there is some test cases that we need to work on. So here, as a part of the test, you see he has created a Directory class, which is going to give me the Chrome and Firefox. That's fine. And then you have a class called Expedia Guai Bibo Wisdom QA. So in Wisdom QA class, you can say, just call the Wisdom QA constructor. There is a method called verify title. There is a method called capture error messages. And then you have Guai Bibo, which is having the same thing, verify title, capture error messages. Okay. And then Expedia is also having verify title. And then there's a method class called test driver. From the test driver, you are basically calling the respective methods for verify title, capture error, quit driver. That's it. It's a very simple structure again. So that's the implementation that we were expecting for you to do it. So I will upload this implementation, go through it, run it in your system, ask me questions, and we should be good. Are you guys happy with assignments? Are you guys the assignments that we are giving you, are you happy with it? Are you feeling it's too hard, or can you give me some feedback about it, please? Okay. So guys, assignments are your building blocks. You have to spend good amount of time towards completing them. Don't take it lightly. Try to complete them as soon as possible so that, you can keep up the speed. Some are easy, some are challenging. Good, Coach Shiley. Good. Yeah, you need to start with easy and then you go to challenging. Even if it's hard, it's good for us. We will break our head at least. Yeah, that's right, Kaushik. How about others? What do you think?
Yeah, I think kind of the same. Some of them are hard and some of them are easy.
Good. Tom, Daniel, Narinder, what do you think?
Oh, well, yeah, they're very interesting. Some are not easy, but I gotta just study the structure as you, now that I saw, I gotta probably in these days, this weekend, I'll try to go over them again.
Perfect, good. Narinder, what's up with you? Am I unmuting you? tell me.
Yeah, hi. It's like obviously it's starting for me. So there is some things to be understand, like in a class things. I'm learning it. Hopefully, I'll be there week's time.
Okay.
I'll catch you guys in a week's time.
Good stuff. Thank you, Narendra. Thanks for trying. Gokul, what do you think?
As of now, I didn't start any assignment, so I will give my feedback for the next week.
Okay. You have seen the videos already, or you're watching the videos already?
Yeah, first three classes I already have seen, but this week I did not get time to access the other videos. So for the coming week, good amount of time to access all the videos, so I will do it.
Good. Thank you, Google. So I think that's pretty much about it. Pinakshi, I didn't hear from you. How are things with you? Pinakshi, are you able to unmute yourself? Let me unmute you. No, I'm not able to unmute her. Can you add something in the chat? Yeah, I think you're unmuted. Can you talk now? Do you have a problem with your mic or something? I'm not able to hear anything. No, you're not audible, Pinakshi. I think you have some problem with your mic. Try to use a Bluetooth headset with your laptop. That will work better. All right, so that's pretty much about it. I'm going to do one thing last, that is just to give you a quick talk about today's topics.
So okay. Can I just ask, I found that 5 days was just enough time for me to complete the assignments. Would it be possible to put them up if they're already ready to go? Would it be possible to put them up a day or two earlier so that we can maybe start them, say, this afternoon or whatever? Just for that.
So you mean the assignments, you're asking that we should put it up like Saturday itself so that you can take some time and do it, right?
Yeah, would that be possible, like, for us today?
Yeah, I will do it. I will do it today itself. I will do it today. We are already ready with it. We'll do it today itself. Perfect. Oh,
brilliant. Thanks.
No problem. Thank you. So, okay. So in today's class, this week, we will cover three different videos again, which is if-else video in if-else and switch case, understanding access specifier, understanding Java methods, a little bit more details. Inheritance, I have already spoken about inheritance in the extends, using extends. You will know a little bit more. Constructors, then we have method overloading, polymorphism. I have already given you an understanding about runtime polymorphism, but I think it's there as well. We have spoken about a simple test framework, then WebDriver locator strategies, what is XPath, absolute and relative XPath, WebDriver locator, finding simple web element using XPath. So these are three different videos that we are giving. Pavan, just want to understand one thing. The runtime polymorphism, have I explained it again in video number 9 or how it is? Are you there?
Yeah, I'm here. You explained it, Savik.
No, I am explaining about runtime polymorphism in video number 9 or in video number 7?
Video number 9, thanks.
Okay. Because I just saw that assignment in the for runtime polymorphism, right? So I'm just confused whether I have already explained it earlier or I'm going to explain in video number 9.
It is in video 9.
In this video 9. Okay. All right. Yeah. Perfect. So I think you guys will get another understanding of runtime polymorphism better in video number 9. And these are the three things that we will be covering this week. I'm going to upload this right away by today, end of the day, so that you guys have the access to assignments and the videos and everything as soon as possible. And yeah, that's it from my side. There is one more thing I wanted to let you know, that I'm sending every week a Google reminder, the invite for our class, okay? I want you guys to accept it, because otherwise I am not sure if you're joining the class or not. So it's better that you basically get the invite in your email and you accept it. Anyways, the link will be the same link like I have shown you here. This is the live link that we are going to use, at least for the free sessions. And after that, for the paid sessions, these link will be changing to a different link. But at least for the first month, we will be using this link. So that's the situation. Please accept the invite so that I can know who else is joining. So that's it from my side. Have a great week ahead, guys, and learn hard. I'm always there. You probably have seen that Tom and Daniel, whenever there's having any issue, they are contacting me in the Slack, me or Pavan. We are supporting you guys. You also will have to get the same support. Just ping me there. I can definitely help you. I think I helped once Juan or Shobhan probably. So yeah, I am always there to help you out, and please ping me so that I can help you in this journey.
Before we go, can I ask a question?
Yeah, tell me.
Interested in the driver factory and the assignment there, but I'm going to look over the solution to see if I can implement that. But if in the solutions like that, we can have comments so that we actually know what's going on in the code so we can understand better.
Yeah, so I think I'm giving some comments. That's fine. I mean, it's not problem. We can add some comments as well. I mean, yeah, I'm not giving comments everywhere, but some of them I'm giving comments. All right. Makes sense. Perfectly fine. Pavan, can you take care of that, please?
Yeah, Savik. And you can, for 1 minute, you can ask that a PPS is there, Savik. It gives them some clarity.
Yeah. Perfect. You're right. So in here, let me open the PPT itself. So we have, this PPT has been prepared as well. I'll give you the access to it. So you see assignment number one, create a rectangle class and define length. So I think that's how it has been shown, that the same thing, just given a little bit of color to it. And you can easily understand that we have created a rectangle class with two properties, attributes, and all the objects are created like this. Assignment number two, similarly for car class, a similar kind of a structure has been shown. So this is also a good way to understand what's happening here. A basic level and then a random number generator has been used. So you can look at this, guys, as well, that we will be uploading. Also the comments, it's a good suggestion, Victor. I will ask Pravan to add comments, so that, you know, it's easily understandable. So yeah, that's it from my side, guys. Happy learning, and reach out to me whenever there is a issue. And I will upload today's class and rest of them as soon as possible. Everybody, whoever didn't got into Slack, please get into Slack so that, you know, all the information can be shared across Slack. I'm anyway sending mails, but I will also share it across Slack. So yeah, that's it from my side. And any questions, guys? Anything at all? I like your name there, Gokul. It's Go Cool. It's just really good. That's a good one. Yeah, show me your face, man. You have a beautiful face. Come on. Why are you hiding behind? Good, guys. Hello. Hello, everybody. Victor, show me your face, buddy. Come on. Are you there? Yeah, that's like a man. Don't see you, man. It's totally dark. Yeah, now I see you. Now I see you. Good, man. Hey. So, perfect. Perfect. We have everybody here. Daniel, Pinakshi, Narendra, Sharon. All right, guys. Have a great week ahead. See you guys next week. Same time, 10 o'clock Irish time, 2:30 p.m. Indian time. And that's it. Have a great week ahead. Happy learning.
Thanks a million, Civic. Bye.
Bye-bye. Good
weekend. Bye.
Bye-bye, guys.
Bye-bye. 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 Bye-bye.